This is how I would become a self-taught software engineer if I was starting over from scratch. Hi, my name is Antonella. I am a software engineer who used to be a fashion designer and went back to school. I started learning how to code on my own and then ultimately went back to school for computer science. So I've seen both routes and I know what's lacking in both of them. That's why I wanted to put together this ultimate guide of what I would do if I was starting over and trying to become a self-taught software engineer. This covers a lot of the things that I saw during my computer science degree, a lot of things that I didn't see during my computer science degree, and what the ideal set of mindset habits, study habits, and topics that I would have done in order to transition from being a designer to becoming a self-taught software engineer with no previous experience. Before we dive in, I want to thank the sponsor of this video, SCRINTAL. You'll be seeing SCRINTAL throughout the video because that's the platform I used to create this plan and mind map all the components of this pathway. As someone who switched careers and started learning how to code on their own, I went through the ups and downs of both pathways. I understand the difficulties of trying to learn on your own, and I understand the drawbacks of going to school for a computer science degree. To be honest, I was very disillusioned about my own experience at my school, and there was a lot of content that lacked in that experience that I had to supplement on my own. So this is the plan that I've been using to supplement my knowledge and the one that I would have used had I known before what I needed to know to get to this point in my life and in my career. I am now a year and a half into my career as a software engineer working at Microsoft, and this is the plan that I would use to get a really well-rounded education that neither path gave me alone. This video is going to be split into four parts. The first part is goal setting. You can't really embark in a journey this difficult without having a North Star or a goal that's driving you. It's gonna get difficult, it's gonna get frustrating, you're gonna wanna quit, and this goal and this vision is what's going to keep you going. The second part of this video is still not going into the technical content. We are covering mindset. Mindset is a lot more important than you might think, and it's, again, what's going to get you through the difficult times when you just feel like quitting. Mindset itself is a lot more important than the technical skills because you need to learn how to think as an engineer and how to get through the difficulties of the journey into becoming one. The third part we'll cover will be all about the technical knowledge, the computer science foundations, and interview prep. They're all sort of related, but each one has its own unique component that will be really important to create a well-rounded engineer. And lastly, we'll talk about networking. This right here is our SCRINTAL board. SCRINTAL was founded in Sweden and is a digital canvas for converting creative ideas into structured knowledge. It's great if you want to do mind mapping, if you want to flesh out ideas, and if you want to draw connections between different concepts, topics, or thoughts. It's not only great for planning projects and coming up with ideas, but it's also really good for researchers and for studying. You can find on their website a lot of different ways in which it's been used for studying, for university classes, and for research purposes. You can get 10% off of your SCRINTAL subscription for the next 4 weeks with my code Antonella10. But now let's dive into my board and go over the plan to become a software engineer. This right here is my SCRINTAL board with everything that we're gonna do to become a software engineer. First part, as I mentioned earlier, is setting a goal. In order to set a goal, you want to ask yourself, what do you want to accomplish with this journey? There's really no point in learning how to code, in starting anything new, if you don't know what you want to get out of it. That is the marker that will let you know whether you're getting closer to something or further away, and what should determine your motivation to continue through the difficult parts. So for example, some of the goals that you can set are, I want to become an iOS developer that focuses on building native applications for iPhone devices. If you want to be an iOS developer, that's a great one for you. You can also set out to build for all different devices. That'll be a different type of scope that you'll be learning. You can also set out to be a web developer. You can set out to be a backend engineer, There's a lot of different things that you could do, but you need to be clear from the very beginning what you want to be focused on so that you can really be intentional about the time that you're spending into learning something new. There are thousands of things that you could be learning, so you don't want to spread yourself too thin and try to learn all of them. You're just setting yourself up for failure. You could be really focusing on just one of them. The next step is look for job postings that you are aiming to be qualified for. That is gonna be the map for you to know exactly what you need to be studying, what you need to be practicing, and what your portfolio needs to look like. So for example, let's say you want to be an iOS engineer. Here is a listing for a position at Lyft for iOS engineering. This listing right here will show you exactly what is expected of an iOS engineer. So for example, here we have, as part of the UI and architecture team at Lyft, you will be involved in creating the design system and our unidirectional architecture that all engineers use to develop at Lyft. Who you are. You're enthusiastic, blah, blah, blah. You get excited about new Swift features. That's a key word. You need to be learning Swift then. You find delight in building the foundations and frameworks to accelerate the development by others. That's another key point. You're a diplomat who looks at the landscape and aligns engineers from different teams. So they want a lot of collaborative work. You really want to show that in your portfolio and your work experience, which we'll touch upon later on. You're excited about scaling millions of lines of Swift code and hundreds of mobile developers. Our apps are used by millions of people, et cetera, et cetera. So they're pointing at scaling. That's a huge component of this. Our code base is written entirely in Swift with modern design patterns and coding standards. This is a gold mine for you to set up your plan. You can watch some of their presentations to get more context. Open source contributions. This, not all listings have this, but the fact that you have access to this is amazing because you can learn from them. Using Mapper to parse JSON and Swift. Like this is, they're teaching you. They are directly teaching you. So if you want to become an iOS engineer, this is gold. They have a GitHub repo. I've never seen actually a listing have this. So this is such a great opportunity, Hammer. If you can't touch this, it's hammer time. That's funny. I am dating myself, but that's fine. Look at this. You have a whole repo here that you can pull from, that you can mess with, that you can learn from. As a little side note, there's this trick that I use at work, which is going into repos and looking at the PR. Look at what people have contributed and read through any comments, read through the commits themselves, and see what work they did. So you can see right here what they included. This is the absolute best way to learn, hands down, and this is how I learned at work. So that's a tip right there. Now switching back to what we were talking about, setting a goal. If you want to become an iOS engineer and that's the goal that you have for this journey of yours, you have it all here. They want you to help to continuously modernize their iOS architecture. They want you to use declarative UI libraries. Like, it's all here. It's just a matter of working towards this. If you want to become a backend engineer, same thing. You just go and look for positions and start picking out the main skills, languages, frameworks, anything that they're looking for. You make a list of that. That right there is going to be your North Star and what you will be planning towards. With that information in mind, we'll move on to setting your statement. So you're gonna start learning X language because whatever reason, if you're trying to become a game developer because it is widely used in the game development space, you're gonna write that for your own case. Once you have that, we move on to the mindset. The mindset is arguably the most important part of this whole journey because if your mind is not right, any setback is going to derail you from the course that will get you to your ultimate goal. Make sure you have a really good foundation for your mindset. Just tell yourself, I am capable of learning new things with time and discipline. If you are consistent, if you allow yourself the time, and if you are methodical about what you're learning, it will happen. I wasn't any sort of genius. There's people switching careers to tech all the time. It takes a lot of work, and I'm not telling you that it's gonna be easy. It's gonna be hard. It is a matter of consistently putting in the work, and you'll see that you'll make it happen. Here, you can add your daily thoughts. When you're feeling frustrated about your journey, you come here and you tell yourself these things. What if everything works out for me? I am capable of learning new things with time and discipline. I have everything I need to succeed. Learning takes time. All of these different things that you can tell yourself so that you won't get discouraged. Moving on to the meat of it, the knowledge section. First is getting context. It's really hard to learn how to code because you don't have full context of what all of that entails. Sure, learning how to code is just writing hello world in the command line and getting a message back, but that's not all that programming is. You have a whole set of concepts of technical knowledge that you don't know when you start, so you don't know what you don't know. And this step is meant to overcome that. You first want to get a sense of what programming is in general, then what programming languages are out there. Understand the difference between Java, Python, and Swift. Why would you want to learn one over the other? This is really important so that you don't start learning at random and then realize this is not what I want to be doing. Learn about frameworks. What are frameworks? Do you need to be learning about frameworks? Which frameworks do you need to be learning? Basic programming terminology. All of this is important so that you start off on the right track. This, I'm setting it up to be week one. You can take longer, you can take less. Week two and three are deciding what part of the whole area of programming you want to dive into. Is it, like we talked about, mobile development, web development, machine learning, AI? There are so many things. I recommend you start with something that you're interested in, otherwise you will most likely quit early on. The second thing I recommend is to read the book, How to Think Like a Programmer. This one is good because it gives you the thought patterns and the frameworks that you need in order to be a successful programmer beyond just knowing how to code. So that's a good place to get started. And the next thing is to actually learn how to code. There are two main paths you could take. There are, of course, infinite ways to learn how to code. The two recommendations that I have are either to start with the web dev intro course, like this one right here, or to jump into the deep end with something like Python. With a web development course, you have a smaller gap to breach from what you know right now, which may be nothing about programming, to starting to understand the main concepts. With something like Python, there's a larger gap to breach, but you're starting with something that's a lot more versatile. You can do a lot more things with Python, and you're going into something that's more programmer heavy as opposed to something that's very UI heavy, like web development. Web development can be very simple with just HTML, CSS, and a little bit of JavaScript, but it's an initial stepping stone that can lead you to a path such as developing web applications, mobile applications, stuff like that. Learning plain old Python can be really good for you if you're trying to go back-end development, like something in AI or machine learning, then this is a really good way to start your journey. Now we have the mindset, we have the goal, we know how to print hello world in the console. Where do we go from here in order to get to being a software engineer? This is where we start with the computer science foundations. One of the most popular foundational courses out there that is absolutely free is Harvard's CS50. This is a full introduction into computer science, and it is a university course, so you will be getting one of the best courses that you can get out there that university students are getting. I didn't get such a good education, so take advantage of this. Once you complete this course, you have a few different options. You can dive into projects, you can go deeper into systems design, which is a very important topic. I recommend this book, Designing Data Intensive Applications. It's the one I'm studying from right now. Other things you can do are backend development and API courses from Free Code Camp. The second column in this section is all about your projects. Once you have the foundations and you have been practicing programming for a while, you really want to start right away working on your own personal projects. For example, again, if we're looking at the perspective of wanting to be an iOS developer, you have courses out there that will help you with that. You can go from there. But what I would recommend is to come up with unique projects of your own. I have come up with a system which is the Venn diagram of project system. You can watch me go into detail in my previous video, but essentially you create two lists, one with all of the interests that you have about life in general, and then another one about all the tech stuff you want to learn. And you combine those and you come up with projects. Make sure you have a running list of that. And I also recommend having a document like this where you dump all your ideas. First, it keeps you excited and motivated. And second, you have a place where you can go immediately and know, oh, this is a cool thing that I want to build. That's gonna really keep you a lot more excited than if you follow a tutorial and it's just like a random recipe app that you don't really care about. Like if you don't like cooking, then there's no point in creating a recipe app. This is gonna ensure that you stay engaged and curious and excited about your projects. Something else that you wanna go into is unit testing and integration testing. That is a huge topic that is really important. No matter what you're doing, you always wanna be testing your work. Important to look into. And lastly, one of the things that will help you the most when you're learning is contributing to open source projects. A lot of engineers start with open source contributions or make open source contributions throughout their career for a variety of different reasons. I would suggest to start doing contributions to open source projects on GitHub as early as you can. The next thing you want to be focusing on while you study and you build your projects is building your network. It is extremely hard to find people around you that are doing the same thing, that are programming, that are already engineers. And so it's important to create a network of people that you can rely on through that journey, you can find inspiration from, etc. Some of my suggestions are to share your journey on social media. That is how I started my whole journey. And document what you're learning. Helps you stay accountable and it inspires other people that may be wanting to start but are afraid to do so. You can also join Discord groups to find, that's a typo right there. You can also join Discord groups to find people on your same journey. There's a ton of programming Discords out there, whether it's for interview prep or Web3 programmers, whatever you want. It's out there. It's just a matter of finding your community. Along that line, find an accountability buddy. If you can have someone that is on the same journey or a few steps ahead of you, that is going to be an invaluable source of advice, of support, of accountability, hence the name. And the last three things are going to coding meetups, which can be nerve-wracking, but the more people that you can meet in person, the better. Going to hackathons as early as possible is also one that is really impactful. And starting your network on LinkedIn. Your LinkedIn network in particular will be pretty important when it comes time to referral. A lot of those people could be potential referrals. You wanna start building those relationships before you need something from them so that it can feel a lot more genuine than just reaching out to someone for a referral. Last, but certainly not least, is studying for interviews. Honestly, the one that I struggled with the most, because interviews are a beast of their own and they have very particular subjects that they cover. The way that I studied for technical interviews was by using Cracking the Coding Interview and making sure I covered most of these topics. Another thing that can vary when you're aiming for full-time roles is that the interviews may be based less on data structures and algorithms and more on the specific topic. So for example, again, if you are applying to an iOS engineering role, the interview may be more geared towards iOS just by the nature of the role. But that depends on each job posting and the hiring managers and the company, etc. Next thing that I would highly recommend you do if you're preparing for specifically data structures and algorithms is practicing your lead code and doing PRAMP mock interviews. PRAMP is a website that I used when I was just starting to apply for internships and I was really scared about interviewing. So really, I just used that website to rip off the band-aid and get over the fear of talking about technical things in front of someone else. It was really useful. It pairs you with someone else who is trying to practice for interviews. So you may even get a buddy out of it. I really recommend it. I only used the free track. I think it's one interview for free. And lastly, you want to do role-specific interview prep.
For role-specific interviews, you need to research what the interviews are like for your specific area. For example, here you can see on Glassdoor, a lot of people share the questions that they get during interviews. We have someone interviewing for a senior software engineer position, we have software development engineer, we have machine learning software engineer. This is the part where you have to go out and research what the interviews are like for what you're aiming to become. But that is it. You are ready now to fly the nest and start applying to jobs. Good luck.
And there you have it. That is exactly what I would do if I was trying to become a self-taught software engineer today. You can watch my previous videos if you want to hear about my journey and if you want to learn how to get experience without having any professional experience yet. Thank you for watching and I'll see you next time. Nico.
Vení, papi. ¿Quieres hacer un ronquido? Haz un ronquido para el público. Vení.
Ah.
¿Quieres roncar? No?